So my special guest today is Brian Lynn. Good morning, Brian.
Good morning. Glad to be back with you.
Brian is our science and technology specialist at Learning English. He has some really interesting stories that he shares with us here. What story would you like to talk about today?
Well, today's story is a technology story, and it has to do with self-driving vehicles. And we've done quite a few stories over the last several years about this technology and how it's progressing, specifically in the United States. And this story that ran on our website yesterday is talking about in the state of California, they have approved testing of the self-driving technology with no drivers in the cars. So up until now, the testing that's been done has been done with the driverless vehicles, with a driver in the car in case something goes wrong or they need to take over. They can do that. Now they've done enough of that kind of testing where the state of California feels confident enough, at least with a couple of companies, to let them test in limited areas with no drivers in the car. So it would be truly driverless tests. And the story also goes into another part of the U.S. in Arizona, the Phoenix area, where they're also doing the same kind of testing, and they have been for quite some time, I think over the past year, again, in a very limited area, have been testing the cars on the road without drivers inside. The latest one that was approved in California, it's a company owned by General Motors, and their plan is to launch car sharing services, so kind of taxi service with no drivers nationwide. Eventually, they want to do that. Right now, they're still in the testing phase in California, and this is going to be happening in San Francisco, in the city of San Francisco, probably by the end of this year. They haven't actually started these tests. So that's kind of the story. And it seems to be one further step in this technology, at least in the U.S. And so it'll be interesting to find out, too, I think, from some of the people with us today, how this technology is developing in other parts of the world, because this is specifically a U.S. angle.
I neglected to introduce our associate, Greg. Greg, would you like to ask a question about this article?
Sure. Yep. So my name is Greg. And a question that we have is, does your country allow driverless cars?
There is no such system in my country. No system. Till now. Maybe in future.
Okay. Bino says in Nepal, there are no driverless cars yet. It's very mountainous, right? When Brian mentioned that they're testing it in San Francisco, that's also a very, very hilly city. So
In the story, some of the officials were commenting that it's probably they're going to go neighborhood by neighborhood in San Francisco and try to determine, I guess, the most ideal and safest neighborhoods to start the testing in before they move to areas where it's heavily congested and like you say, maybe where it's very hilly and a lot of stoplights and stop signs, and that would be more complex and have more chance for accidents happening. So that was the plan of the company. They said they were going to take it neighborhood by neighborhood and see, and then also meet with community members in the neighborhoods and find out what concerns they have and try to answer their questions about the program.
To answer the question that was, does your country allow driverless cars? Where you, in my country, in Peru, there is no such technology that allows cars to drive by themselves. Well, there is a huge problem here in Peru, even with cars with drivers, because here people don't respect the transit rules. So I think it is going to take a while to have this kind of technology here. But I really amazed by this news, because I'm a huge fan of technology breakthroughs. And I think we are going to enjoy a lot this kind of technology, because it's the next step, I think, for self-driver vehicles, not only cars, but, for example, planes or another kind of vehicles.
Well, we have drones, mm-hmm. right, which are kind of driverless planes.
Ah, yes.
Yes, Dr. Gil. I think here in Egypt, we doesn't have the driverless cars, but I think in Dubai they start something like this, as I hear. But for me, I will not feel comfortable when I stay in a car without a driver, because I think whatever the artificial thinking comes or reach a high levels, it will not be like the human thinking. So I will not try such thing like this.
Mm-hmm. So Yasmin raises the question of what they call artificial intelligence, right?
Yeah.
And Brian, is that part of these cars? Do they have kind of an AI of
They do.
Brain, yeah. As you would say.
Yeah, so they have a range of tools to kind of navigate, for the car to be able to navigate. Cameras, mainly a bunch of cameras around the car. And it's kind of works off of machine learning or artificial intelligence. And you know, that's one of the concerns that's been brought up is how do you make the artificial intelligence think quickly in certain situations, like a person could, and react very quickly? It's one thing to be able to have the car positioned on the road in a certain way and be able to recognize a sign as a stop sign or a stoplight and other cars and be able to stay in a lane. A lot of the new cars have some of that technology already to assist the driver in staying inside a lane or in helping stop if they're getting too close to a car ahead of them. So these technologies can work quite well, but then the question is raised, what happens if a person comes out in front of the car quickly, or some object appears that the system, the AI, doesn't recognize and has to react very quickly? Is that going to happen? And that is really the main reason that these drivers up until now were in the car during the testing, so that in case something like that happened, they could react. And there was a case in Arizona of one of these cars when it was being tested actually did hit a person who came out in the street a few years ago, and that really slowed down the process of the testing. in various states. That was in Arizona. There is this question about AI can be used, but is it going to be able to think and react as quickly as a human could in certain situations?
Yes. I think this could be explained or something like that. I think if this kind of technology allows cars to drive at a low velocity in the beginning, maybe we can recollect a lot of data. This has to happen, because if we compare the driverless cars with the driver, we can see that technology sometimes could be better than humans, I think. As I said, here in Peru, for example, we have a lot of traffic accidents because people don't respect the rules. Mm-hmm. So even if driverless cars have accidents, I think they are less than the accidents that humans have.
And the artificial intelligence would not be under the influence of alcohol.
Yes.
Which causes some accidents too, right? Jim, what's your comment?
Yes, Dr. Gil. I haven't seen a driver's car in Turkey, but I remember an article from past March. I remember that a driver's car produced by a firm under the scope of joint university industry projects tested in Istanbul last March. It's only a test process, but I think it will be continuous to real driver's car in Turkey traffic jam. And I think there are a lot of pros and cons about this problem or opportunity. One of them, there is no human error because computers always tells true, zero and one. There is no options. I think computers better than human behaviors. And I think there will be a lot of less accidents and deaths. And maybe no more drink driving, alcoholic drivers, I think. But on the other hand, computers very easy to hacking. Maybe bad people hack our technology or foreign countries. It would be very dangerous, I think. Mm-hmm. And of course, taxi drivers lost their jobs. I think my opinion is it will be very good future for me and our children. I'm excited to see driverless cars. It's fantastic, I think.
So here's a new word that we Jem introduced, to hack. Let's see, Greg or Brian, would you like to explain what that means?
Yeah, so that's would mean an attack on a computer or an electronic system connected to a computer network. And the idea would be to, when you hack in, you attack, and then you can take control of that device. So in the case of driverless cars, if someone were able to hack that car, then they could, in theory, take control of that car, and could be steering whatever direction it wanted. And that has been brought up by critics of the technology as saying that that's a very big concern that these companies would have to deal with, and would have to persuade people who were going to use the technology that it was not going to be hacked.
Suppose I use that auto car, driverless car. Now I first planned to go to San Francisco. Now I want to go, first I planned and then a car, and I changed my mind and I want to change, Los Angeles. Then how can we change that system?
So rerouting in other words, okay.
Yeah, I think it would be easy to change that, the routing, driving. It seems like the first way it's going to start in the United States is going to be with ride-sharing services. So especially in the cities where, these taxi services where people can just get in the car, they put in their address through an app, through their phone. The car comes, picks them up, then they put in where they want to go. Car comes by itself, drops them off. So it is fully automated. And in the beginning, you were saying auto car. There is another word we use in the story called autonomous. Mm. And that's autonomous, and auto would be short for that. Mm-hmm. Just means that it's fully operating on its own. So that's a word that is used in the United States quite a bit in relation to this technology, autonomous vehicles. Mm-hmm. Kind of a big word, but that's...
But if I write small enough, it'll fit on my little board.
Just barely.
There you go.
Yeah.
I think to hack any system these days is quite impossible. For example, if we want to hack an email, for example, or a Facebook account, it's impossible nowadays, unless the person allows you to access the account. And for this kind of systems, I think the cars would be a lot more secure. As I said, with the development of quantum computers, because there is one, I think, I heard in IBM, in the labs of IBM, and one application of this kind of technology of quantum computers, of quantum processors, are the security, the security in computers and passwords, and this kind of problem, I think the solution is here.
He's right that IBM is doing a lot of work on that currently, and Google is also developing this kind of supercomputing power. And I'm sure that's going to be one of the arguments for you know, in favor of these kinds of technologies going forward, because so many devices already that we have are, you know, in theory hackable. Our phones, a lot of other devices, security devices, cameras that people have inside their home, even some appliances that you have in your kitchen are connected through Wi-Fi and could be hacked. So yeah, I think it's going to be, they're going to have to make that argument to people to convince them that they're not going to get hacked. Google is another company, as I said, they're working on this supercomputing technology, and they've made a lot of progress, as IBM has. They are also one of the biggest companies developing this technology. So there's a company called Waymo, and they're also testing autonomous vehicles in, I think, several US states currently. And they are owned by Alphabet, which is the parent company of Google. So, and I think that it's like so many other things. If this technology starts slowly and there are accidents, or maybe someone is killed by one of these cars, then you're going to see it pull back. The same with hacking. If they start this technology and you do see hacking happening, they're going to pull it back and try to fix those things.
Yeah. In fact, Tesla has a car that kind of can drive itself in a way, right? With the person there. Right?
That's right.
And that's
right.
There's been some accidents with those, I've heard.
Right. Right. That, yeah, they have, it's called autopilot, the Teslas, and they are almost fully autonomous as they are now. They've had several Tesla accidents that have been investigated. And so that's all another thing that slowed it down.
Yeah. So I was thinking I would ask if you would use a driverless car, and in which situations do you think it would be most and least beneficial?
I think there's if I own a shipping company, this technology could be very helpful. You know, mm-hmm. I heard about in the pandemic, they use drone to deliver the things to household. And if the road is ready, the technology is safe to use, we can use self-driving car to deliver goods or something like that. You know, it could help the shipping a lot.
Okay. So delivering packages and boxes, that kind of thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right.
I love to ride an autonomous car, but I didn't get the second questions. What?
In which situations do you think it would be most and least beneficial?
Suppose I have a taxi. Okay, I have a cab, so I run a business. So that would be least. This would be hampered by business, I think so.
unless you changed your business to have only autonomous vehicles, right?
Yeah.
Then you wouldn't have to pay people, right? But then all your drivers would be out of work. Maybe they could become computer programmers and program the vehicles.
Yes. As I said before, I wouldn't like to use it, but I think it would be most beneficial if someone go every day out of his house with a crowded city, so he can have a time to focus in something in the car without need to be focused on the road.
So when you have to go someplace, but you don't have time to drive. You have other things to do while you're going there. Uh-huh.
And if the city is very crowded, if you live in a crowded city, you will spend a lot of time in the street.
Okay, so it would be, you could use your time in traffic to do other work.
Yeah. Actually, I love to use a driverless car because I commute by car now. Mm-hmm. But if I have a driverless car, I can read books while I commute.
Ah, okay. You wouldn't have to be focusing on the road, as Yasmin said.
Do you know if Japan is testing the technology?
Yes, now in Japan, and some autonomous vehicles are tested in the limited place, like a private park or a private place. But now we don't have any driverless car.
Because I'm still very young to have a driverless car. So for the technology or for our traffic in our city, it's not very fit because it's only a small street. So it's not very fit for the technology. But if we have all auto ticket station, it can make the city not have the traffic jam. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that would be a benefit, right? To reduce traffic jams.
Yes.
I think.
I think if I have a chance to take a driverless car, I will try, but just a short ride, or get experience of a new technology. But I will not use a driverless car usually in life. I mean in usual traffic, because in my opinion, driverless car is an uncompleted technology used in life, especially in Vietnam, because the traffic in Vietnam is very terrible, and the streets is so crowded. And a driverless car totally possible to get in an accident. So I will put the safety on first, so I will not use a driverless car.
Okay. Yeah, so it might not be the car going into something, but something else running into that car, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
I already answered, but I have one of questions only.
Okay.
Can I ask? So nowadays people are very concerned about environment, okay? Does a driverless car use a fossil fuel or is an electric vehicle? What about?
The ones that are being tested in the US are electric. So this company Cruise, that's owned by General Motors, that's going to be testing in California. They are fully electric, and that's another thing pointed out in the story is the company says it's a goal of theirs to reduce greenhouse gases, and this would be a really huge way to do it. Another point several people have brought up about the traffic jams and how many cars are already on the roads. One thing the companies are bringing up too is they're saying that in cities especially, they're hoping that this could actually reduce the number of cars, because if you have enough of these driverless car services that people can use, they won't have to own their own car, and that the idea is going to be that moving into the future, a lot of people wouldn't have their own cars. They would be relying on these car services to get around, especially, as I say, in the cities. and that would actually reduce the total number of cars on the road, which would be better for the environment and also would reduce traffic overall.
Brian, are there driverless buses or or trains?
I don't know of any transportation vehicles like buses that are being tested in the U.S. I know they've had larger vehicles to carry people within certain areas, you know, within a, let's say, a big amusement park like a Disneyland or something like that within a limited area.
Like a monorail.
Right. So as far as
elevated train.
Public transportation, I'm not sure, but I wouldn't be surprised if it would also move in that direction in the future as well, with, like you said, with buses especially. Trains, I would imagine, eventually too. But as far as I know, there haven't been tests going on with those sorts of things, at least not in the U.S.
I see in the article there's one idea that they say this technology is revolutionary. It's not something that gives the immediate impact to our life, but this technology, they see it as a step-by-step process. And I totally agree with that idea, because I it's not like the internet, you know, the internet gave the very impact to our life. And self-driving car, I think we have many years to go with this technology. You know, first we have the technology ready, next we have the road ready, and then we have to set up the regulation for this kind of vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
We see it not very clear, not very near future. It could take a quite a long time, I think.
Yes, I agree with some comments that it is the future. I think also that the more cars driverless cars are, the better service we get, because I think they have kind of sensors that detect people, that they could that allow them to drive better. So I think when driverless cars are more number, they could share data. For example, one car has sensors, the other car has also sensors. So if they share this data that are collected by them, so the sensors could be more precise, and it could be a huge advance. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that is the word, but I think it would be better, because they could detect better, accidents would be less than we expected.
Yeah.
I again say that it is the future.
Well, it's definitely moving in that direction. And he was also mentioning about how these systems would be connected with different cars. That's definitely been talked about. Also to have it somehow tied in with the signaling in the city, the lights, so you as a way to improve traffic. And as we get closer to the 5G technology, which we've also done several stories on that on our website. That's going to be very important in helping all of these vehicles communicate with each other and also integrate with different parts of the infrastructure of the city.
With this technology that Mr. Brian mentioned, the 5G technology, I heard that the amount of data is going to increase exponentially. So I think that would allow this kind of technology, artificial intelligence, have more to more data. So they are going to improve a lot, I think.
Yeah.
That's what they're saying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the question is, will that data, will the use of the data be beneficial to humanity? And we hope so. So here we're getting data from all over the world, and I see that our time is up. Thank you, everybody, for joining us today. And let's thank Brian for a fascinating topic, as usual. Thanks, Brian.
Thank you. Brian. Okay.